Hey guys, welcome to the Casey Catch Up. This week we talked to Oskar Johansson, the current world record foil for pumping around in the surf, basically on a surf foil. And we did over 2 hours, 40 minutes. Mind blowing. We go into what gear he was using, why he used that gear, the conditions he was looking for. We also go into board design, why prone hand paddles are becoming a thing, and it might be a bit easier than you think. But also want to take the chance to just thank you guys for tuning in to the Casey Catch Up. I'm trying to get them a bit more regular now, so have them every 1 to 2 weeks. So heading into summer here in Australia, there should be a few more downwind foilers getting into it. So I'm stoked on that. I'm also doing a few clinics over in Western Australia with a few races, November 10 to November 20. I'm over there. I'm going to do some clinics down in Mandurah and the Mandurah Dual race. And then the following weekend, I think it's the 19th of November, I'm doing the West Coast Downwinder on foil too. Bunch of clinics leading up to all that sort of stuff too. So if you're over there or you're looking for a downwind foil race to do, come over and join us for, I guess we're calling it Downwind Week, November 10 to November 20 over in Western Australia. Fingers crossed we get good wind. Conditions are generally really good. Oscar can vouch for that. He was just over there. And yeah, so I just want to thank you guys for tuning in. If you want more content, more info on downwind foiling, check out the Coach Casey Club at my website, caseyaus.com, caseyaus.com. And yeah, we'd be stoked to have you. But if you're just enjoying this podcast, stoked. Get into it. The more people out there, the better. And it's not going to get too crowded out to sea, not in the foreseeable future anyway. So looking forward to catching up with you out there. And yeah, get into it. This episode with Oscar is a good one. Cheers, guys.
All right, welcome to the Casey Catch Up. I've got Oscar Johansson on, and mate, I've been meaning to get you on since that world record prone surf foil. There's so many world records going on at the moment, but world record prone surf foil. You literally blew everyone out of the water. I was embarrassed that you even listed my time in that. I like 39 minutes. I'm like, oh, but 2 hours, 46 minutes on foil in a surf break. No backwash, no free rides, no nothing. Just so I guess we're going to talk about that, and then I also want to talk about the other thing I want to talk about with Oscar for this podcast is the hand paddles. And Oscar's made it look really easy, and made a lot of people want to give it a crack, which I'm stoked on. It's another way to downwind. Whether it's easier or not, that's what we'll discuss. But also, I guess just the process of how you've got there. But yeah, thanks for coming on, Oscar. It's
Yeah.
been a little while since we had you last, but
Yeah, stoked to be back. It's been a little while. Things have changed in that little time. I mean, the last time I jumped on, I was just getting into the stand-up stuff and sort of sup downwinding, but things have come a long way. So it's crazy to see a sport like this grow because I mean, that was only a few months ago, and you see how much things have changed since then. It's crazy.
it's blowing up. In
Yeah.
all the good ways. Like there's not only I think is gear getting better, but I also think people's skills are getting better, which is I think almost more so than gear, I think, but we're learning how to use the foils the most efficient way. And well, let's kick it off. Let's talk about your stupid almost 3 hours in the surf up on foil. I'm really interested in this because I tried once and got 39 minutes, and I'm blaming conditions, I'm blaming equipment, but I'm also just blaming like desire to do it. That's what stands out to me the most. To me, I thought, oh, 39 minutes on foot, like that's a long time, I thought. But 2 hours, 46 minutes. Was it times five almost? You just literally,
Yeah,
yeah.
it's an interesting. I mean, that's my which I think a few people know, but you know, I don't. My sister's a pro triathlete, and so I spent, I think pre-COVID, I spent a fair bit of time with her. She was training over in Boulder, Colorado, sort of the mecca of endurance athletes for their off seasons and doing training and stuff. So I went over there and hung out with her and just got. I never run. I was never into that stuff. I did sports when I was like growing up. I loved surfing. I played a lot of water polo, actually, a lot of swimming. So, but I was never competitive. I was just not it. I didn't have a drive for it. And hanging out with her, I went on a few runs with her, never ran before. And I got pretty hungry to push yourself hard. There was something about it. And like, we're super competitive. So, like, if she goes on a run, it just doesn't matter how unfit I was at the time, I just stare at her back and push myself and make sure I don't get dropped by her. So, yeah, I think, and that kind of eventually lent into what, like, this stuff is. Like, once you can kind of foil aerobically, it is that, exactly like you said, it's a mental thing. And it's really how hard you can push yourself, you know, physically, your body can keep going. But mentally, yeah, you go to some dark place. I mean, you would have done it on your downwind run that almost 12 hours, 213
Ks. Yeah, yeah.
So you go to some dark places, man. Like, your body's shutting down. Everything in you is telling you to stop.
Mm.
And to mentally keep pushing through that, I mean, I felt that was just something with the running that I really got into and strangely translates now into foiling, which...
Yeah, yeah, it's that aerobic, I guess, just burying yourself. You know, just let's go. Yeah. Let's see how far, how long.
how far can I go? And yeah, I weirdly got into it. It was something that I've never pushed my body to those limits with her anyway, doing a lot of the running stuff and cycling. And I mean, the cycling translates so well to foiling, really similar muscle group. And depends on what, you know, one of the rides that we tend to do is very hilly. So I was like really spiky, kind of heaps on the way up, then you get a rest on the way back. And I think that translates really well to foiling, that kind of similar aerobic zone, but also similar muscle group. So
there you go. If anyone wants to break Oscar's record, just go cycling. Just don't foil, just cycle and run. That's all you got to do.
No technique. It's all in the legs.
Yeah. So we all know that's not true. Oscar's very talented foiling. So, but also you're pretty dialed into your equipment. So I was really interested in we'll talk about before, just before we started recording, the gear you're using, and just run us through that. And I'm going to, I guess, and we'll compare it to what other people tried using, like myself and Bennett's and Jeremy and Perth and all these guys. So
yeah. So I ran a, well, board was just an Armstrong prone board. I think it's a real stiff board. So I think I get a really good power that I'm pushing down translates well into the foil.
Mm-hmm.
And it's long mast track, so it's easy to move it a bit forward to kind of reduce that swing weight, just keep it nice and efficient. It's 27 liters. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, for me, I'm light. I mean, when I did the run, I was almost 72 kilos. I weighed myself afterwards and I was 71 and a half, which for me is actually heavier than normal, which I'm normally sit like just higher 60s. So
probably build some muscle while you're out there.
Yeah. So I was a little heavier, but that's all right. Then so front wing, I was riding the 1325 high aspect from Armstrong. It's not their biggest, which was one reason I kind of steered away from the biggest, because I knew everyone was going to be like, you're light, and that's the biggest foil. So I kind of went one size down. Like, but, and then I had a very long mast. I had an 85-centimeter mast, which it's actually it's my go-to anyway, but it's more I was concerned about being up for that long, making mistakes. Anything can go wrong. You kick off a bit, you hit a wobble, whatever it is. Yeah. So really, I just wanted a bit of leeway. And then, real 60-centimeter fuse, I think pretty standard these days, not long, not short. And then a crisp tail, which is a guy over in WA that makes them. So a really interesting foil section. They're super lifty for what their size is. Really unique foil section in it. So generates a heap of lift, but also not much drag. So, and I think that kind of complemented that big high aspect, just kind of being able to make mistakes, being able to kick off, something goes wrong, you're off balance, just having that little bit lower stall speed but still have that top end, that kind of felt like the winning combo. So I had a run the night before. I did 45 minutes the night. I sort of just went out and I was like,
see how I get.
I had a kind of a week window before I was traveling, and I kind of just said, I've got a couple, there's probably 3 days of good conditions, and I was like, let's just go out night before, like, let's just have a run, see where the legs are at, see how the body feels. And
it's a quick 45-minute wave to see how we're going.
But for me, it was, I just took my Apple Watch out, and it was more just testing what the heart rate did. So try and look at the average heart rate over that 45-minute period and just see, is it just slowly, are you just working yourself until you can't anymore, or could I just flatline? And it was flat. So
the trick. Like, I think a lot of people ask, like, for me, how did I do such a long foil? And it's, as long as you can keep your heart rate under control, and you can refuel. And I just read your post. If I had more nutrition, I probably could have gone longer, 3 hours, which I totally agree. Like, if you can keep your heart rate down and you can refuel, there's no difference between like an hour and a half and 10 hours. Seriously?
Yeah.
Once you get over the hour mark, it's a new game. And getting into that hour and a half, 2 hours, if you can get to 2 hours, you can actually, well, you showed us, you can get further. And you weren't even refueling. Like,
yeah, yeah. So I think that was probably what was my biggest issue was, you know, I was in a 3-2 wetsuit and just
that.
Full sun. I was just, and like you saw it like halfway through, like the sweat marks coming through the wetsuit. I was just, and that was, you know, towards, I think it was 2 hours 30 or so, it was just the leg cramps. Like every down pump was like, just don't go too deep because you knew the legs were going to cramp. And it was, so I think after, but looking back now at the heart rate data, it was still pretty level. It wasn't, it was a slight increase overall, but it wasn't getting to a,
wasn't getting anaerobic.
Yeah, exactly. And I think, you know, I wasn't fit for the, you know, going into it, I kind of had a goal of an hour 15. And I was like, oh, if I can get an hour 30 and like just smoke Bennett, so I was like, that's the goal. I was like, yes, an hour 30. So that was my, you know, that was my goal. That was what I was going for. So I was like, I don't need water or anything for an hour 30. I can push through that. So
I didn't
plan any of that. And I think
you needed a caddy on the beach just to sit there on the inside, just hold up a bottle of water, muesli bar.
I actually had apple. I had a friend who came out with me, Reese, and I was like, I could ask him for water. I was like, go up to the truck, give me a bottle of water, just throw it to me. And then I was like, someone's going to have a dig at me. Someone's going to be like, oh, you got external nutrition. And I was just like, well, you know what? I'm just going to leave this simple. Like,
oh, you're going to put it out there. There's no external nutrition is allowed. If you're going over an hour and a half, external nutrition's allowed.
Yeah.
But if you go an hour 29 and you got water, doesn't count.
You're out. I like that.
Talk us about the conditions too, because I liked at the beginning of you said you sort of called Bennett's out and said wedges, backwashes does not count. That's not pumping back out. That's my problem with this world record. It's so hard to to quantify and to get everyone in the same conditions because you know I want to try to break your record by going out as one of the long point breaks. Imagine you went to the Superbank and you just sort of going from Snapper and it was a good day and was going all the way to, you know, Kira and you just like, oh, one lap and then just get into a rhythm back out and then get another. So I'm not sure if it'd be easier or harder, but it's, you know, talk us about the conditions and what you were looking for as your ideal conditions for that setup.
Yeah. So yeah, I didn't mean to call Adam out. He's one of the best boilers.
He's good for it.
He's phenomenal. Yeah. But, I think that what he did there, that they've got such a good setup with the way that kind of side wash kind of bends around that, you know, they're essentially, you look at the clip that he put up when he did that hour 7 and, you know, he rides it back out from one bump to the next and rides that back. And, you know, I think that's a whole different game. I almost think that for me would be harder because you've got to be so much more in the game, much more focused.
Yeah.
So to me, whereas, you know, what I was doing was you kick off into it, you know, kind of a channel along the side of the bank and you just kind of zone in, get into your rhythm and you just kind of then ride back. So it's a little bit more monotonous, but what he was doing, you've got to be on your game more. So
different.
I think that had potential for more mistakes. Yep. Whereas what I did, I set those rules to be just something that almost anyone can replicate. If you've got just a peak that crumbles or breaks, it's just ride it for as long as you can, pump back to the same point and just lap it. And so, you know, it's kind of ideally I would have gone with offshore winds, which I had at the start for probably the first hour. And then towards the second hour, the wind started to swing and it was just a slow. It got worse. And then by the end, it wasn't strong, but still, you know, probably 5 to 8 knots. Still.
This is, I guess, how I explain it. If there's a 5 to 8 knot breeze and you're foiling 10 knots into it, that's a 15 to 18 knot breeze. And that's significant in flat water or up into a wave and swell.
Yeah.
So,
And so then there's, you know, there's little, especially where it was, you know, the wind sort of bends around. So you sort of, you got a painful headwind, but then as you get out a little bit, you can kind of turn with it and you use it to your advantage as much as you can. But, you know, it's still, I think it's conditions dependent. You got it, like with your downwind run, you know, you want 12 hours of wind going in one direction. Any other direction is, it's going to hold you back. And so ideally offshore winds, but, you know, you just take what you can, really.
Yeah, probably no wind is the best.
Yeah, yeah.
And if it does come up, just like a 5-knot offshore, I think it'd be the dream. Like if it was going to come up from any, but no wind, I think, from my one attempt when I had a little northerly come up and all the excuses in the world as to why I didn't even get 40 minutes. But it's not about me, it's not about you. And what wave size? What about wave size and period? Because I think that's something that definitely needs to be discussed.
Yeah, yeah. So initially, the night before, it was, which for us was still a decent period, I think it was 9-10 seconds. Mm-hmm. So I was on the lower end, but to me, doing a longer run, I was looking for a lower period swell. As soon as you get the higher period swell, you got the bigger lulls between sets.
Yep.
And so I'd probably say on your pump back out, you've got maybe 6 waves to choose from, I reckon.
Yeah, okay.
At most.
Yeah.
I mean, you can go further out if you see a really big one coming, but you ultimately you sort of bank.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think even, you know, for the spot, it's not too bad to go off the bank. You know, you can just keep going further and further out. And that was one of the reasons why I rode the 1325. It's got a higher stall speed than other wings, but it's just efficient and it has a like good top end.
Yeah.
So it's more if I do get stuck and, you know, if I kick off one and there's just absolutely nothing, but there is a set but quite a way out, on the way back, I can stay with it. I know I don't have to pump with it, whereas other wings, I might have to pump with it to kind of just either to pull back into it or to stay with it.
Yeah.
So I just knew that it was, you know, it's a compromise. You can't. Yeah. Can't go too slow, but then you also get the benefit of I can go further out if I need.
Yeah.
So that was one of the big decisions backup behind plan. That wing. Yeah, yeah. Exactly. But yeah. So you probably have 6 waves to choose from, and my biggest thing is just not exerting. You know, if you go 7-8, say waves out, the further you pump, the higher the heart rate goes. So on your pump out, it's just slowly increasing.
Yeah.
And the higher you get it, the longer it takes to get it back down. So if you go way up to 190 BPM. It's going to take you 5 or 6 waves to get it back down. And if one of those waves afterwards, if you miss it, there's a big lull or whatever, you're going to then, you're just going to keep maxing it and keep going up and you're done.
Yeah.
And that's where like, I was just like, all right, 6-ish waves, just get a feel for kind of what your heart rate's doing. And if it's starting to get into that really hard zone, you got to peel off and just take what you can and just not get into that upper zone, that anaerobic kind of. With a red zone or whatever.
Yeah. I want to stress how much harder this is than downwinding. Like people probably think, oh, you know, James has done 12 hours or 11 hours, whatever it was I did, and you've done 3. Why are we clapping Oscar so much? Like with the wind at your back, you actually never feel like you're pumping into or against, or you've always got power.
And
honestly, when I did mine up at Fingal, I was, after 15 minutes, I looked at my watch. So I didn't want to look at my watch to see how long I'd gone. I'm like, I'll look at my watch now. Probably done about half an hour. Look at my watch. I'm like, 15 minutes. I'm like, this thing's broken or something. Like, cooked.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
It's hard. Like, because riding a
wave. Nowhere to hide.
You're thinking, okay, got to maximize this wave. But then you ride too far in and you're stuffed because it's a longer pump out. Or you get into this sort of weird, where it was a bit of a weird eddy rip. Wrong end of the bank, like it was pumping back out into a wind. And then if you pull off too early, when you pump out and around, there may be no waves. So you pump too far out and then you got to pump in as well. So there's this, not only are you surfing a wave and trying not to make a mistake, you're then having to pull off at the right time, not too early, not too late. And then you need the luck of a set coming or conditions. And you need the wind not to pick up, and you need the tide to stay the same. And it's not as easy as Oscar makes it out to be, or what Bennett's made it look. And actually, that's something I want to talk about. Was I think you're doing something different to what everyone else's attempt was. Using a bigger foil in a, I guess you almost controlled the variables more by having just one break and a clear rip back out. And if there's an option of 6 waves, to me that, like, there's not many of those in, like, there's not many setups, not many beach breaks like that in Sydney where you get from when you pump back out 6 options. I think normally where I surf, it'd be like 3. Like on the way back out, you might get a choice of 3. So a good setup, but not something impossible to find.
Yeah. I think it's like where we are, it is a lucky setup. I think just the way it's, there's a reef out the back. Usually it's a reef all the way. And that was probably the hardest thing was the tide, because the weeds start to stand up. So you got to stay away from it.
Yeah.
And I think on the way out, like if you're picking one of those six waves, there were times where there were nothing and you just, you pump out and you pump back. You'd pick a lump, the best lump you could see, but, you know, it wasn't towards the high tide, which I thought the swell was a little bigger. Towards the high tide, nothing broke. So it was pump out, ride what you could back, but it was more don't go over the reef too deep because you'll hit the weed. And so it was always a little bit of a play with just positioning. And it was pretty, I mean, it was more interesting, I thought, just like to see, to spend that amount of time and be so connected to the energy and what's going on for like a almost a tidal cycle, a full high and kind of coming back out of it. And you see there was, you know, there was that big lull on the high tide. Everyone sort of talks about it surfing, goes, oh, tide's turning. It's, oh, there won't be any waves for half an hour. And then it was sort of like, you're getting into it and you're like 15 minutes in. And I was like, shit, there's not much coming. And I was like, fuck, it's right on high tide. And I was like, maybe there's someone to something there. And the way, you know, then as the tide gets lower, the wave will move around the reef differently. Yeah. And like to be so in tune with that and to see a full cycle and how you're literally watching every wave go through. You're concentrating on everyone. You go, is that the one? Is that the one? No. That one's got too much wall. And like you tune into it in such a different way, which I thought was awesome. It was really cool.
I noticed the same for mine, but it was 30 minutes or not even. And I just noticed the wind slowly build. And I'm like, man, this wind's making it hard, you know. But like you notice all those little things and the waves break in a slightly different spot. But you would have been bloody, you're part of bloody the ocean. You were a bit of plankton out there just going around and, you know, just like you were with the cycle. It's very cool.
You got to find the rhythm, find the energy. And even, you know, you notice if a set goes through, how much water is then moving through on the inside and everything changes. You see a big set go through and then you start to go, all right, is it worth going all the way in? Because it starts to get turbulent. There's a lot more going in at the shore. There's a lot more water that needs to get back out. And so you start making those calls and, you know, you're cooked. That's the other side of it. You are mentally, you're trying to concentrate, but your body's just so cooked.
Yeah.
And so it was an interesting journey. And I think that's where like the running, the cycling, you can just almost black out and just push yourself as hard as you can. But foiling, you still have to concentrate. You still have to be conscious. And that's where, like with your 12-hour one, the staying focused for that amount of time and, you know, foiling's minute movements, little pitch. Yeah. You're always constantly reading every bump that comes to you. Do you compensate with a bit of pitch move? Whatever it is, you're always reading it. And that's where, you know, I don't know where the limit is because, you know, it is aerobic, but mental
fatigue.
No idea.
I actually, I've done probably more downwind than I have trying to do this, but I find the downwind easier because with the wind at your back, the patterns are almost, for me, they're more, they're easier for me to read. Whereas doing like half an hour and a half, 2.5, 246 in one surf spot, not only does the surf change, but every wave is different by like a lot, depending on the angle, depending on, you know, there's shallow spots, there's weed in some spots, there's turbulence. And to me, that's, I think you have to be more aware of what's going on. And I'm going to bring it back to comparing your run to Bennett's run. And Bennett's had, you know, a drone and a land footage and making GoPro and something on his head. And, you know, he had all this stuff. So we saw him surfing the wave, like, and not surfing conservative, like in any respect. Like he was ripping and just decided at like 50 minutes, oh, I may as well go for, see how long I can go. To go for an hour and seven, ripping like he was, is, despite the backwash and the sidewash and all the stuff helping him, super impressive. But I think it's actually something very different to what you did. I guess you've controlled the variables more by having that rip, by choosing to set up the spot you did. I think for to try to break your record, which you're probably be the next one to break your record, but to try to break it, you probably need, like, to me, I'm thinking after seeing you, your average on your GPS was, it said 13, but I think we talked about before, the GPS sort of cut the corners, so you're probably closer to 17 or 18. To be able to do that, I think you need a big foil so you can, and I think the smaller the waves, the better, because there's less difference between when I'm riding the wave and then when I'm pumping back out. The closer you can have those two things together, the easier it is going to be to relax on the wave and then almost and relax pumping back out. Whereas if there's big swell and you have to use a smaller foil,
you have to work harder on the way back out, is how I think about it. That the energy differential is greater if the swell is big, because you have to use a small foil when you're riding the wave and then a big foil to pump back out, or, you know.
Yeah, so yeah, absolutely. And I think, yeah, the bigger the swell, the more varied it is set to set. Mm. You know, there's the more energy it has, or a set has, it's interacting with headlands, with the contours of the bottom a lot further out than it would if it's a small swell. It just interacts closer to shore.
Mm.
And so there's less variables to read in the swell, less things to go wrong. And I think, yeah, you're totally right. Like, I eliminated as many variables as I could. Realistically, I just wanted like one peak, and I just wanted it to be solely, really, it's just a fitness thing. Yeah. Of course, there's, you know, experience and kind of just kind of finding that rhythm with the ocean. But really, it's a lot on the fly. And that's where, like downwinding, as you said, you find a good rhythm with the wind, the swell, and how you kind of link those bumps. And with this, every time is different. Sometimes you just do jump over two waves, quickly get a small one because there's just nothing coming in. Pump a little, like do some short laps, then commit to a bigger lap if you saw something.
Constant and also decision making. Yeah.
Lots of decision making. And I think that's those variables are what, you know, maybe I got a lucky run, who knows, but.
Nah. Maybe 2 hours 46 isn't lucky.
Yeah, so it's, yeah, as just eliminate the variables and get it as to as simple of an equation as you can, and just, yeah, small swell. I think almost a shorter period, just so you don't have the kind of lulls between the sets. Yeah. And ultimately, I know WA, which I just spent some time over there, they've only got one tidal cycle a day, whereas we've got two. So,
yeah,
you know, we've got more aggressive tide, so it changes rapidly. So if you're somewhere that isn't as tidal, or just has smaller tides, also another thing that'll kind of make it easier. But
yeah,
and there's so many variables and
small periods, small surf.
Yeah,
no tide. Man, it, honestly, it's really impressive. Well done, mate. And
thanks.
That was you can. I think you said, like, I think it was a comment, like, I might have lit the fire in your belly for this. And to me, it's completely different to downwind foiling. And like, I could do 3 hours downwinds like tomorrow without training. That I'd have to tune in my equipment, I feel like, and the conditions. And I even find just downwinding in like 5 knots and no swell, almost offshore wind, easier than what you did. So when you were like, kept to be in the one peak, I'm like, oh, there goes my plan of just going like out to sea and just downwind and then come back to the same spot, if you know. But it's in the surf zone, really well done. And I guess also it's worth mentioning that the Armstrong 1325 I haven't used, but obviously all the high aspect Armstrong stuff I've found is quite a high stall speed. Obviously the 1325 would be less high because it's a bigger foil. But and crisp tail obviously lowers that stall speed too. But it's a fast foil, and you make it look pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, that was it was my big debate before it. I think the 1325 is really similar to the ART 1099 from Axis. Mm-hmm. I think similar amounts of lift, or for me anyway, if I'm powered up on a wave, they're pretty similar amounts of lift. But yeah, as you said, that it's a little quicker. It's but the compromise is the higher stall speed. So
yeah,
and I think, you know, my weight being pretty light, I'm not as worried about the bottom end, but it was more the top end that sort of, I just knew that if I went far out, I need something that, you know, even if I go quite far out, we'll still be able to just ride that lump, kind of more of a, not an open ocean, but faster lump.
I guess the best way to explain is, as the wave comes into shallower water, there's more drag or friction, and in deeper water they move quicker. It seems as it approaches the waves the way it wraps in. It around headlands, it does different things to out in the middle. Let's move on for that. That's amazing. Let's go into downwind. And you've just been to Hood River and did amazing things over there, but also hand paddles, prone, downwind foiling on an Armstrong prototype board that you helped design, or probably maybe did design or put input into. Talk to us about that. And you put up a clip of you paddling in with just swimming hand paddles, not the Dave Kalama dinner plates, just standard, you know, cutting out the webbing, essentially swim paddles with holes in them too. So they're not even bad.
Yeah. Extra pull,
but talk us through that.
Yeah. So we got our Hood River was all on a smaller downwind board. So it was a 5.11 narrow. I think it was about 19 and a half, 19 and a quarter around there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was me and it was another guy, Nathan Took, who's the currently, I think, the CEO of Armstrong. But we kind of went like, he'd had no surf experience and it was early morning. The wind was around. I'm like, let's just try prone paddle them up. And, you know, I think in the ocean without paddles, you'd need a pretty big board, especially like there's no way in the conditions that we had you'd be able to do it. Or say in the, if you put the flip side within the ocean with 18 knots of wind, no paddles on a 5.11, you're not, I don't think it's happening really. Mm-hmm. And I think the way Hood River works, if people don't know, you've got wind going in one direction down the gorge and a current going in the other direction. So it stands the waves up. They're really steep and vertical. And especially at the location that we're at, I mean, as you start to do downwind runs down Hood River, you go through the wave change or the bumps change so much from spot to spot. Like every 100 meters, they can change. And the spot that we did it sort of gets a heap of refraction that sort of bounces off the rocks on the side, as well as those sort of quite steep bumps. You get really wedgy swell. So it was just, we didn't know it was possible. And we just sort of went out and you just kind of realized quickly that you find one of those wedges and you're going to be going, like you're going to be up. So,
yeah.
And both of us, we'd got a surf background. He didn't have any SUP experience. So it was harder for him or almost impossible for him to even contemplate trying to SUP it. So we're just like, let's just try prone. And that was sort of one of the first little light bulbs that went off. And, but to be honest, I kind of just put it to the conditions. I was like, it's Hood River. Like, is it really possible in the ocean? I was like, probably not.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, it's coming back. And it was only, there's a guy, Jordan, from Eastern Suburbs in Sydney, who started making these hand paddles.
Yeah.
And I saw his post and he was flat water. I think I've seen KD Maui do it too, like trying to flat water start with
like the hand paddles. Knees. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And I was like, oh, you know, but I, same thing. I saw the knee stuff and I was like, oh, like that's kind of hard too. But for me, I was like, surely you could just prone paddle in. So
yeah.
Yeah. Yesterday, it was last night. This same time last night, I took out the next size up. So the 6'6" Armstrong board. And just little swimming hand paddles. Yeah, holes all through them. I noticed as soon as I got in the water, I was like, oh, like I feel the water going through the hole. I was like, okay, these aren't great, but let's give it a go. And
yeah,
I think, yeah, you can put a lot of power down quick because you've got two hands, got you going absolutely crazy.
It's, I guess it's the equivalent of a surf ski, you know, that, but where's the paddle?
Exactly.
Boom. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think one of the things was it was really, I think I've always, from your podcast, been kind of trying to tune into the whole feel the bumps, feel the push. But laying on the board, you feel so, you're so, one is you're stable. You know, you're not worried about instability. You're just laying there and you just really feel the pushes with the wave. So it was, even though, you know, you can't look back as far as you would when you're supping, which is a good thing also.
Yeah.
But you just really, you really get the feeling for that, oh, that was a big push. And then you just, fall back into it and really go. And you know, it's interesting, like we just chatted about it before, and it's saying Zane Westwood just sent me a message before this and he said he had a crack with the Jordan's paddles as well out on the northern beach. So I don't know how much wind you guys had today. I didn't hear, but
a little southerly, I think. Yeah, I'm in Victoria right now, but I think the guys were downwinding, so I think it was windy. Yeah
And so yeah, he said he got up, he said it was way easier than he thought. So
yeah.
And I think, yeah, there's plenty to unpack in that. But, in you know, we come from a surfing background. So for us, quick, hard paddle and a pop up to the feet is very natural. Like that's bread and butter to us and it's so instinctual.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, then learning the SUP for us was that was hard.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's a like, oh, forget about the SUP and just go paddle. I think it's depends on your background. There's a lot of variables that will come into that.
Yeah.
And I think ultimately, if you get a light push, or with the SUP paddle, you can work it up. You can kind of keep going with it, get that kind of to release and get it up. But with the hand paddles prone, I don't see it happening. Maybe on your knees, you know, watching those guys.
Yeah.
Maybe you can start to work it up on your knees, but then you add in being on your knees is less stable than laying. So,
yeah,
less you know, the power, higher up you get, the less stable you're going to be. So, you know, there's...
Yeah.
I don't know.
Nah, so, and I'm I haven't tried it with the hand paddles. I've tried it on a 5.0 or something. One of the first downwinders I ever did was in Maui with Finn and Jeffrey Spencer, and we just chipped into a wave and downwinded, and I was on a Maleco, the original Maleco, whatever it is, 180, or it is smaller than the 200. And that sort of put me off prone because I fell off like halfway between two bommies or two bits of reef, and I had to paddle to the next reef. And then the chip in wasn't easy because it was a wave that was pretty big and breaking into deep water. So it was too big on the outside and then too small on the inside, too less, not enough power on the inside. And I couldn't paddle into bumps, not the 4 footer that was like 28 liters. So I was like, well, and on a small foil, this is 5 years ago, I was like, ah, SUP makes a lot more sense to me because I've done a lot of SUP racing. I grew up surfing. Like, I was a surfer first. To me, the paddle allows you to pump and paddle as you're getting up. Not only before, but as you're halfway up, you can take another paddle stroke. Whereas if I'm prone and I'm going to pop up to my feet, then there's a moment where I can't just generate my own speed. I've got to get to my feet and then I can pump. Whereas if I can generate my own speed and pump at the same time, that's where I see the benefit. But I want to try it now. Yeah.
I actually talked to Jordan today. I hadn't talked to him for ages, and he's just sent me a pair of the paddles. So I'm going to dive into it a little bit more deeper just to kind of, and I think, like you said, like, it is that you can work a SUP, you can work it up. If you feel that bump, you're kind of there, you can really, you know, you can take 20, 30, 40 more strokes, just really start to work it up, get that speed, get it on foil. But with especially prone, you've got a split. As soon as you make that call to jump to your feet, it's either you're up or you're not. There's no real way around it. There's no way to keep getting power in.
It's got to be a good bump. And that's and that doesn't mean they're not out there, but that's what's held me back from trying it. Is I can get up like 10 seconds if in half decent conditions and with the big foil, like 5 seconds in good conditions with a big foil, and then maybe if I'm using a smaller foil, it's like maybe 10 to 15, maybe 20 seconds at the most. But like, that's my, if I fall, I'm back up in 20 seconds.
Yeah.
Like, literally, I did a run of Zane the other day and big nor'easter, and I fell 3 times. And I looked at my falls, like my kilometers for those times I fell. It was no more than 20 seconds added to any of those kilometers on those falls. And so Zane was like, how did you catch me? I thought you fell 3 times. I'm like, my foil was the right speed for the bumps, but I was just falling a lot. Mast was too short was my excuse. So I'd winged on a 90 centimeter and then like an hour before, then went downwind on a 75. So more excuses.
But the point
is I can get up quick, and that's
And that's what's interesting, because I think, I mean, again, I've done this now. Well, I did it once at Hood Rivers, which I'm kind of neglecting. I didn't have paddles, whereas now I've done it once, and it was once. Yeah. I laid on the board. I got like, had, you know, I could kind of got a feel of the bump, went for one and was like, oh, that was okay. And I sort of sat up and then went, oh, all right. And then it was, again, 10 seconds later, I got up. So I don't have a whole lot to...
Not a big sample size.
Yeah, it's not a big sample size. To go, yeah, this is what I'm doing.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I think... You know, the blades that Jordan's got, I think, are about 80, 82 square inches. That's the same size as my paddle blade. I got a Sonova 82.
Yeah.
I've got one of them in each hand. And it's that, you know, with the SUP, it's that one stroke, pull, and there's a lag, you know, then the next stroke, pull. Yeah. And, you know, I'm not the quickest sprint. I don't have any
SUP. You're not a paddler. Not a paddler.
And that's where prone. I just got like bang, 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 bang. And it was maybe 4 strokes, tops. Yeah. And it's such a short, quick acceleration. But with the SUP, you get that push and then you stay with the bump, you work it, get the release, and you drop into it.
Yeah.
Whereas with that, it was just, you've got that, it's a much shorter opportunity and a very fast, everything. Explosive. Just bang, go, and it's either yes or no. And so is that reliable when you're out doing a long run? I don't know. Because very small sample size. So,
But the other thing, I guess, to think about is if you have the confidence that you can get up in, you know, like out to sea, whether it take and like yeah I guess my what I'm trying to say is if you know have the confidence you're going to get up out to sea with those hand paddles, one, I don't know about you, but like a fall during a downwind run isn't a common occurrence. Like if I'm doing a 10 or 15 kilometer run, if I fall, it's like, oh, I fell today, like how bad is that, like I fell, and it's like, damn it. So you may only have to do it once, maybe twice, you know, and that's, it makes it, I guess, more appealing. I don't know. Yeah. Like it's like, it gives you the, okay, it's not that, like, I know John Florence and his brother Nathan Florence have been doing like Turtle Bay to Mokalay. It's like a 35 kilometer downwind run, maybe longer even. Not, it's on their prone boards on a lift 120 or something, and they're just, they're out to sea a long way. There are reefs if they fall, but they don't seem to fall. But if they do, they've got the confidence that they can paddle to an outside reef break and chip in and keep going. In Australia, East Coast, that's not really the case. If you fall, you have to go to a point break or beach break and chip in and pump back out to the wind line. I guess, yeah, what I'm trying to say is there are people that don't fall for downwind runs, and so it's less important for them to get up again. So if you're doing a downwind run and not falling very often, and there's no seaweed and there's no turtles and there's no rubbish to run into, you know, because that's seriously, they're usually sometimes they're some of the bigger causes of falls.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I think, and that's, I think I look back on it now, and I was did a run last week with 2 weeks ago with some guys that were sort of new to it. And I sort of I took them on. We did the run that I normally do. We took a ski with us as well. And they were sort of like, you did this by yourself. Like, you know, I've got a headland that sticks out pretty far, and it's a good 25 Ks home, but you end up 3 Ks offshore if you just go straight. And you're cutting left as well to go out even wider for a lot of it, so you get an even straighter run at the end.
Yeah.
And they're like, you did this by yourself. And it was my second run ever in the ocean. And I was like, you know, the first run was in a bay. So it was sort of, you always had an escape plan along the side. Yeah. But this was like, all right.
Let's go.
And to be honest, like, it's that confidence. I don't know why I had that confidence. I look back on it and it was like, that was probably not the best. But
yeah.
Yeah, I was ambitious. But it's saying I didn't fall. You know, I got up once and that was it.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I've never struggled with the staying on foil. But I think it's that you need either, whether it's equipment or whatever, you know, SUP or paddles, you need to be confident that you can get back up out there.
Yeah.
And that plays in your mind. You end up wasting a lot of energy if you're out there pumping too much because you're too scared to get even close to that stall speed, rather just glide through it all. You're wasting energy and just getting nervous. And so if you're confident, you back yourself and just go, yeah, I got this. Like, it seems to work out.
Seemed to work for your prone in the surf too. I guess Zane and I have done a couple just from, I guess it's a 4K run. It's Narrabeen to Collaroy, and you chip in at the point at Narrabeen and go all the way to the beach, Collaroy. And it's just one long beach break, no headlands to go around, which is why we do it. But even on that run, we're like maybe a K, 800 meters to a kilometer out to sea. And the first couple of times, Zane, like, or even still when we do it, it's like, it's a different, we're making different decisions and we're turning less hard because we're scared of falling. Yeah. Like, because it's like, I don't want to fall out here because then I gotta, not only like, not even that you, even if you aren't scared of falling a kilometer out to sea, it's more, if I fall, I have to, on a 4.45, you know, 30 liter board, I've got to paddle in to the beach, find a wave to chip in on, and then pump back out to where I was. So it's a 10 minute exercise minimum, you know, maybe 15, maybe 20, depending on how far out you are. And I guess for me, because I know how to SUP, and I've, to me with the paddle, it's just another question I have for you. What is this, so that 6.6 you're using with the hand paddles at home yesterday, was that board bigger or smaller than what you'd normally use on, you know, SUP downwinding?
Bigger, definitely. Yeah. So, and I think that actually, which is an interesting topic. I mean, boards have changed in the last 6 months or it's just gotten, it's ridiculous where boards, how much boards have changed and how much is coming out, you know, spending time in Hood River, you sort of seeing what, you know, like KT, they were prototyping some boards and seeing what they were coming up with. And, you know, I got to chat with Marcus Targer over in WA over the weekend and, you know, pick his brain a little, and you just see like boards are changing aggressively. And I mean, I think it's one, making it more accessible, like things like what, you know, ultimately so much of this is coming from what Dave's doing, Kalama over in Hawaii. I mean, the Barracuda, which when I first saw it was just like,
why?
I was like, what on earth is that? I just was like, oh, don't, like, you're kind of a bit, it's been a hit. Like, guys are loving it.
Yeah.
And I think that was, a real turning point for boards. And I think the Barracuda is probably extreme, but I don't struggle paddling up. So for a lot of guys, that's the only way you're going to get up is that board. So that's awesome. That just means there's more guys getting into it. And, you know, for me, like you said, that when you're doing a run and you're nervous about falling, a lot of my initial runs, I was alone and I'm middle of the ocean by myself. I'm not used to this environment. I'm not used to it. I'm used to surfing a reef 20 meters from shore, and that's as far away as it gets. So all of a sudden, by yourself that far out, 3Ks offshore, it's intimidating. And I started changing, you know, you're not going for turns as hard. You're nursing it a little. You're being cautious. And I think now that I've gotten better at paddling, I've actually started to surf downwind and actually do not be worried about falling. Because, like you said, it takes 20, yeah, you're 10 to 20 seconds on a minute, let's say.
Yeah, but still.
But it's rare that it's over a minute.
Yeah.
And that's where, like, it's all of a sudden, it's like, I'm not worried if I come down. So it's like, I can do turns. I can. And, like, when you're out there, a lot of guys, you know, just want to go straight all the time, every time. But you get through a good section with good bumps, it's like a skate park. It's like you kick off one wave and there's just a perfect bowly wedge sitting behind it, and you're going straight at it. And it's like, rip into that. And, just, and like, that's where I kind of see the shorter board. So, like, you know, if I do a standard run, I've got the 511, and the mast is very far forward in that, just the way the board's been made. And for me, I can rip it around, I can really turn it. And so it's a whole different sport to surf downwind than to kind of try and go quick. And so for me now, like, just with the confidence, man, I just, like, downwinding's not just the same thing. It's some days let's surf it downwind. Some days let's try and go real fast. And and then you get sections where it's, you know, it just, the conditions change and it's like, I'll do something different. I'll start going quick again. Or
That's a really good point. I chatted to I did my first race in Maui on a foil, and I was frothing on downwind foiling. I was frothing on downwind before that, and just on the SUP, and it, like, you know, the surf or the skate park that it can be in certain conditions. And I went to this race, and I was on the Maliko 200 because conditions were a little bit light. And Nathan Van Buren rocked up with a high aspect wing. I think it was the first one that was used in the race anyway that I know of. And I don't think he either won or got second or third to Kai on an MFC. And I took off, you know, we're all on the start line, we're all excited. Let's go. Racing, take off. And I'm up one of the first. Which I was stoked because I was like, you know, Groms like Kai and Jeffrey and Finn Spencer, just like lightweights, whippets getting up. And I'm like, got a good 10 to 20 kilos on some of those guys. I'm like, yeah, I'm with the little guys. Let's go. And then as soon as I get going, everyone's going past me, and I'm like, man, I'm not even in this. And after the 3 or 4 kilometers, I didn't give up, but I'm like, well, I'm just going to enjoy this run. And I went way out wide to where the bumps are bigger and just started turning and surfing. And I got some sick photos by the boat, but I was like, I knew I wasn't in the race anymore. So, and then after that, I'm like, how do we make downwind foiling not a race so it's more fun? And I was like, I think I've said this on the podcast before, but we need to somehow have like average watches, and that's, you know, not perfect, imperfect, because watches are all a little bit different. GPS isn't perfect, but watches, and that measure your average speed for the run and your total distance. So if it's a 10-kilometer run and I average 25 k's an hour and do 15 kilometers, then I'm winning. But then if you do 10 kilometers but average 28, I'm ahead of you because I've done more distance, you know. So there'll be some sort of formula you can sort of come up with. But I'm like, how do we make it surf downwind foiling and enjoy the glide and the turns rather than just pin the ears back and straight down the line?
And I like that. Longest distance. Same run, but distance.
And you've got to factor in your average speed too, because like I could use a P&G 1300 and like just go super slow and just go across the wind one way and across the wind the other. And that's not fun either. So average speed, you got to factor that in too, but distance and average speed to calculate the overall winner.
So I think there's
something in it. I think there's something in it, especially for the slow guys.
I think that's what's getting kind of interesting. I think for a while there we were, you know, like when I first started foiling, when I first started downwind supping, I think the boards were lacking behind.
Yeah.
So for me, I had to ride something that was had a low end and was really quite lifty, which the compromise was I struggled really. Like when you're out there, essentially you've got your wind bumps and your swell lines. But obviously, there can be multiple of each a little bit, but in general, wind's slower, the swell bumps are moving fast. And to drop into those swell lines, you see them when the big swell lines stand up. quite often I was on a foil that I could start to drop in, but I was either it was a little bit too slow or I just got way too much lift and I had to peel off behind it and then sit in a wind bump to kind of wait for link back into the next swell line behind it.
Yeah.
Whereas now, and that's, I think initially, you know, it was more, we were all just going, oh yeah, foil choice, whatever. Whereas now I think boards have caught up to where the foils are.
I think you're right.
And you see it with so many brands, like guys are going smaller and smaller and foils are getting, you know, I think we kind of, I mean, this is a whole another topic, but I think we all ran from essentially low aspects to high aspects.
Yeah.
And I think we, it was a big jump from a lot of brands. You know, whether you look at it from lift going from the surf wings to the high aspects, Armstrong, same thing, HS. I think Axis did it really well because they had the HPS wings in between the B. Like they were, it was much more of a gradual stepping to get up there. But for a lot of other brands, it was a big jump.
Yeah.
And guys kind of went, you know, oh, no, this isn't working. Like the lift 120, that's impossible to do. You can't paddle it up.
Yeah.
And at the time, you know, the foils were there to ride the swell and the speed, but we didn't have boards that could paddle up those wings.
I agree. The boards have helped, but I think also the, like, for me, the board was it's the sup or the skill, I think, because like Marcus and I have been able to paddle up, like I was paddling up the GL140 when it first came out, like, and that's a pretty old wing now, so it's, and that was on old boards too, I'm not a standard sup paddler. Like there's sup pad, like I always ask people when I do lessons, have you paddled a sup before? Yeah, I paddled a sup. They paddle like a 10.6 by 32 in the lake. Like they're not racing a sup, and even like someone that surfs a sup isn't racing a sup. And there's a skill level, and that's, I was chatting to Marks about, like, because we've been developing downwind boards for like not production, because, and that's another thing I want to talk about. There was never the demand for these boards because no one was interested in downwind foiling. I'd created this podcast because no one was doing it with me. I'm like, come on, people, let's do it. It's fun. And I feel like from Dave and hopefully like my podcast growing the downwind foil game, that the board design has developed. And I definitely big hats off to Dave for developing the big long extreme, and Marcus and I still believe it's over the top for our skill level. Like I'd never want to use a 7.6 or 8 footer downwind. Much in my first board downwind board was a 7.2 by 24,
right?
Which like
that's pretty. Yeah. That's pretty so close, like, to being on the money for nowadays standards even.
Yeah, so like, but we progress smaller and smaller because our skill, like Marcus and I were paddlers. And so we were a bad test pilot because our skill level, for our paddling level was too high for the standard foiler. And I think Dave's too, his initial boards were short and wide. Him learning to prone with hand paddles, like, the Barracuda was a prone downwind foil board.
Yeah.
And his struggle in learning to prone, or his journey to learn to prone downwind foil gave birth to the Barracuda. Like, so it took someone, like, and that's like the fact that he could paddle prevented him from creating something that was good for SUP, but doing something that he couldn't do, which is like you learning to SUP.
Yeah.
Allowed him to develop a board that was good for someone who didn't sup. And that's where I think the magic is. Like, because Dave and Marcus and I have been, like, we've been downwind, just downwind brained for like 10 years. Like, Dave was doing Molokai before I even started paddling. And I then went over to Maui, I was paddling with him in one of my first races. He's, you know, we used to race, Dave and I raced a couple times together, and he smoked me most of them, and I got in the last one. I think he hasn't raced since. he smokes me downwind still when it, on the foil when it's big. But basically what I'm saying is, coming from a downwind, like already knowing how to downwind, didn't help us develop a good downwind board for those that did not downwind.
Yeah.
And it took Dave doing prone board to allow that, to create something that was good for everyone else. And that's where I think we've caught up. That was the breakthrough, I think, to me anyway.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, I guess it's the same thing watching me now, you know, doing prone paddle ups. Mm. That's my surfing, that quick pop up and short shove. That's my bread and butter. That's my background. That's what I still surf probably more than I foil. And so for, you know, some people looking at that going, oh, I'm going to skip the paddling and just do that. It's like, it's the same as watching you go, sup down. Like, you've got the strong paddle, all that, you know, you can sup so well. So for you paddling up, everyone watches that and goes, oh, that looks easy. And it's the same as, you know, I wouldn't watch me and go, oh yeah, sick, that's what I'm gonna do. Like, I'm light, I surf heaps, and like, that's all we do when we paddle in. We've got a lot of ways of just like little chip in and work it up. And it's like,
yeah.
So it'll be interesting. And, you know, maybe, which is one side of, you know, maybe boards will develop towards a prone. And I think the Barracuda is towards that, but because you're not having to stand on it. I mean,
yeah,
you go as narrow as your stance is, really. It's yeah, just, you just want it as long and as narrow as possible. Not as long, because, yeah.
Yeah, so there's, that's worth mentioning. Like, the length helps the paddle speed, but once you're up and foiling it, you know, all the guys in the Barracuda say it's not an issue. They're also on a Maliko run, which is nothing's an issue on a Maliko run.
Yeah.
But if you're not getting up, go longer.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's, like I say to people, like, oh, do I want the 7.6 or the, you know, or the 7 foot? And I'm like, are you getting up? Like, no, just, I want to know if I, once I get, what'll be better. I'm like, forget about getting up. If you're not getting up on a 7 footer, you'll want the 7.6, I guarantee it.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
that is the truth.
You've like, got to get on foil. Like, that's
foil.
As great as everything looks, the hardest part is to get on foil. Once you're on foil, everything's good again.
Yeah.
But to get on foil, that's where all the gains are, whether with the boards, the paddles, all that sort of stuff is all about just getting on foil.
Yeah.
And if you can't paddle up a 7.0, you got to go longer. It's just, or a lot narrower. And I mean, I think it was actually interesting because I learned initially on the Aviator 6.4, 29 wide.
Wide.
Yeah. Actually paddled it recently, just went out with a friend that there was actually a lot of things that I learned about paddling it again.
Yeah.
About things about the tail, like how it picks up that initial bump so much better than what we're on now. And I think you see it with like the Barracudas, that they're so narrow and such that kind of those bevels that come to a point, the bump kind of goes around that bevel. You know, it doesn't get the same push. And even now with my boards that are 19 and a bit wide, I don't feel it as much, even with the 6.6, whereas that old 6.4, it's such quite a wide tail. I got the push.
Yeah.
But then I just couldn't accelerate it.
If that's so, the first time I found that, I was using it, probably since we came out with the Aviator with Sonova, I was using it for downwind. I was using a custom. And then in the surf, I'd use the production. And I was pushing for the production. There'd be a downwind production range too. And basically the owners of Sonova were like, how many of these are you going to sell? Like, who's going to buy a 6 foot by 22 wide board? Who? Like, no one can use it, James. Only you and Marcus are the only two that use it. We'll just make you a custom. And let's make the surf sup foil something that's usable. You know, we'll make it a little bit short, a little bit wider, give it more width. And I was like, yeah, it makes sense. Like, we'll sell more, so it makes more sense. I wish I'd pushed for something longer and skinnier now. Like, honestly.
Yeah, yeah, 100%.
But there was no demand. Like, there was maybe 10 people doing it when we came out with the Aviator, which was 3 years ago, maybe 4 years ago. How things have changed. Now there's it's so cool. I'm frothing, like, to see all these boards. And like, yeah, like, Dave is the godfather of it, I truly believe. But like, Marcus and I have been developing downwind boards for foiling for as long as Dave. And a lot of brands have jumped on it recently. And they're not copying, but they're definitely taking in. And when I say copy, like, I think everything is a copy of something. And if someone copies your stuff, it's a compliment to what you've done.
Yeah.
And like, I had a conversation with Dave, actually was messaging him, and I said, oh, you know, you didn't invent the long and skinny high volume board, because there's prone paddle boards that are already that. I used a Bark as an example, but he said it was actually a different Jerry Lopez and someone, Strata, were the guys that, and I want to get Dave on here to discuss where this inspiration came from. But basically, there's a prone paddleboard that he's used aspects of that to create the Barracuda. What the genius that Dave has done is he took it from paddleboarding, like prone paddleboarding, and put it into sup foiling or foiling. And that's when what no one had ever done before. They go, like, oh, foiling, you want a small board, because once you're up, it's way better.
Yeah.
How do we get up? Yeah. How do we get more people to get up?
Exactly. Yeah. I think he's, and that's actually, I mean, it's interesting looking at, I guess, say, I think where, say, Sonova is at the moment with their new downwind boards, the Elites and the Pros, I think, to me, I think that they're on the money. And I was saying that to Mark, I think that they are. The right things, mate. Yeah. I think you look at the, you know, Dave's boards at the moment, you've got the, I think it's the E3 and then the Barracudas. And I think the E3 initially, you saw it was the first guys that were getting on them were either team riders or team riders from other, you know, from foil brands that were jumping on them, and they ripped. They were super fit guys getting on. And they, you know, it was hard. Like, we all went through the struggle. And like, it was so hard to learn. Eventually, they're getting them up. But for the average bloke, that's not that attainable. I think the Barracuda went to then almost the other extreme, though. It went like, this is so easy to get up. It's really accessible. But I think there's that middle ground. And around that, you know, mid sixes to low sevens, kind of in that range. And I think that's probably where most people will end up anyway.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, which is another thing, I guess, is how far we can push the width of the boards.
Yeah.
And I had it with this latest one, and you know, you see, I think I've seen Kane de Wild on a 16, ridiculously
narrow. I think I saw 14. Like, I think Nathan and Kane are on 14 wide in flat water, but 14, like, my foot is probably bigger than 14. Like,
I think Kane said that he said his foot offset is 16, so he needs to get, he said the 14, he couldn't even offset his feet enough.
Yeah.
But I mean, and that was what's really interesting on this Armstrong for the, and I was, when I got to Hood River, I was like, oh, I'm going to make a fool of myself paddling out on a 19 wide board. I'm like, I'm just going to be all over the shop.
Mm.
But it was barely different to my 22. And I think the, you know, you get to a point where you narrow it so much, but we've got a big foil that sits under there and it's like a boat, it's a keel. And you get to a point where keep narrowing, narrowing, eventually the dominant stabilizes that keel or the mast. So I think we've kind of almost got there. And a lot of guys say that. I know, like, Andrew over in WA, one of Marcus's friends, he was one of the first guys I saw went down to 19.
Yeah.
And I was like, how does it paddle? He's like, pretty much the same as my other board.
Yeah.
But it's just way faster and easier. So,
yeah.
You know, I think while Dave's stretching it out, I'm hoping that we can get it back shorter, but keep it narrow. So, you know, then the swing weight's less, you can surf it a bit more, but still have that ease of paddling up. So,
yeah, I agree.
There's still room for development. So, Dave, fucking keep working, mate.
Yeah, keep working, mate. We can't wait to see what you come up with next. I truly believe that Dave has set the bar for getting people into it.
Yeah.
And I think the other board, what am I trying to say? So, someone that buys a 7'6" Barracuda or 8-foot Barracuda, I don't believe that's going to be their last downwind board or their only downwind board. I think they will, like everyone's done, they will go down to a point where it becomes too short, where they lose that benefit. And like, I've done a lot of, with Sonova and with Marcus, we've done a lot of prototyping, like lots of downwind boards. And we started at 7'2" and we worked all the way down to 5'10" and then came back up. What am I? I'm the 6'3" now. Yeah. But we hung around the 6'6" for a long time, went down to the 5'10", went to 6'0", and we believe that was the best for us. Up around the 6'2 to 6'3 now for our conditions. Yeah. I also think, depending on conditions, the length of the board is going to be different too. So,
yes,
like if I was going to do Molokai tomorrow, it's pretty much a flat start, but wind at your back. And there's little bumps, but it's like a assisted flat water paddle up. I would want a long, skinny board.
Yeah.
So I could get up on the smallest foil I could. If I'm in the middle, if I was starting the same race in the middle of the channel, I wouldn't want that long, skinny board anymore. I'd want, if I was in good conditions, I would probably want a 6'2 maximum and, you know, whatever width was stable, 21 to 14, whatever people are using these days. So I think there's a lot to say in that. Like, as people's skills get better, it'd be interesting to see if people stay on their 7'6" to 8-footers or they come down to mid-six range. That's...
And I think, racing, which is interesting because, I think racing... In a lot of places, it's dependent on how quickly you get up.
Mm.
So using those longer boards, you are going to get it. You're going to get up a smaller foil and you're going to get up quicker.
And unless it's so long that you're making a mistake, it doesn't matter.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, then you've got the other side of what's the finish like? What's the middle like? What's the start like? You know, if you've got good bumps, you know, maybe having a longer board's not too bad. And guys talk about the Barracuda, it pumps well, its swing weight doesn't feel too bad. I mean, if you're going straight, I assume, I mean, as soon as you want to start whipping it around a bit tighter,
that clip you put up of your hand paddling in and then you're freaking throwing that thing around. Like, that was impressive. And that's the balance. That was almost the most impressive thing to me about that clip. Not only did you hand paddle in, but you got up and then you started turning it like you're on a freaking four footer.
And that's what I want to do downwind. And that's why I can't see a barracuda whipping around. Like, maybe I'm wrong.
I know Dave did a 360 on the barracuda just the other day. He's like, yeah, you can turn this thing. He's a freak. He's very talented. I just proned my 6.3 today. I'm here in a clinic in Torquay area. And you can definitely turn a 6.3 just as good as you can a 4. Like, you just have to get used to that swing. And there's less margin for error. It's like, if I'm two nose down, I'm going to nose dive that much earlier on a 6-footer rather than a 4-footer. And
the challenge. And that's, then the pumping with it, however you want to, like, whether it's swing weight or makes pumping, you've still got a longer nose.
Yeah.
So if you've got less room on your mask sort of to be at in that pumping sweet spot. So
if there's backwash or shorter period bumps or all these things, what's tripping up. And there was a few examples. Shep Nelson, I haven't spoken to him about it, but I heard from Julian, I think it was, who said that he had a hard time in barracuda, felt epic in the Maliko run and Kihei, like on Maui. Came to do a race on Oahu, and the shorter period, trickier bumps made it a lot harder for him on the barracuda. It was the first time he felt, maybe this isn't the perfect board for me in all conditions.
Yeah, yeah.
Shorter period, messed up stuff. Real world. I call it real world.
Real world stuff.
Real world downwind.
Yeah.
So,
that was what, in Hood River, because you've got such tight bumps.
Mm.
A barracuda spans peak to peak almost, an 8-foot.
Yeah.
Which is okay,
I think.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, I've paddled 19-foot boards in Hawaii, and people are like, oh, you can't go longer than 17-foot. And we went up to 19.5, and the glide was there. That was harder to control. So the boards themselves still fit in the bump, but it's the ability to control it and turn it from bump to bump, which was the limiting factor. Like, there's guys paddling outriggers and surf skis are long. But it's the maneuverability. You don't get the maneuverability out of a 19-foot board as you do a 14-foot or 12-6 or 6-6 or 4-6, all these different lengths. And that's and if you can't maneuver your board well, as well as you'd like to, then you're then inhibiting your ability to go as fast as you can because you're not putting it in the right spot. And that's where, I think foiling is less of an issue because you're above. But in terms of paddling up on a bump, I don't 100% buy the problem with foiling a longboard. I think is when you paddle up and the bumps are short, when you lift and then go to pump, you risk nosediving that board into the bump in front of you.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's the disadvantage, because once you're up and foil and you're happy gliding, reading it all well, it's all good. But as soon as you get in a bad situation, you get into trouble.
It's very true. Very true. I've run into it myself in different times where you run into the back of a bump and you just nosedive and there's no way out of it. And I was on a 5.10 at the time, and still I was struggling with just, there was a lot of backwash, there's a lot of things, but I was multiple time over time, I paddle up, nosedive into the one, paddle up, nosedive. And I was just like, it's driving me nuts. So you extend that to 8-foot. I mean, I noticed the difference. I've gone from a 4-foot prone to almost 6-foot sup. That 2-foot is such a big difference. So to extend that again, I mean, it's not a linear. It's going to be a bit more like, it's getting worse and worse. It's going to your margin is going to get tighter. So
that's it.
It's an interesting way to look at it, actually. Yeah. Mm. So your first problem is get up. And I think, barracudas are going to get you up easier. But once you're up, there's going to be negatives to it. So
It's,
if you can't get up, though,
you've
got to go long. You've got to go big.
That's where I give props to Dave for bringing the long, skinny, high volume boards to sup. Foiling has made, like, Marcus and I, like, how do we get more people to do this thing? It's like, it's obviously hard, and we know how to paddle, but how do we teach them? And I guess my approach was, I'll do a podcast and I'll go out there and teach people. But I think he just made a big, long, skinny board, and it's essentially a beginner downwind sup foil board.
Yeah. Yeah.
In a, I'm not trying, that's not trying to be, and I'm not trying to offend you, the design. Like, it's not a beginner design by any means. It's long and it's super skinny. It's advanced, but it makes it easier to get going. And that's the genius.
I think Eric says it on his podcast as well. He's like, downwinding is the one place where it's not going to get crowded.
Yeah.
So, downwinding for me, I know I know what you guys are like. I know what Zane's like. Anytime I do a run with Zane, it's like, once you're up, see ya. It's like every man for himself. Whereas I'm like, now that I can paddle up comfortably, as soon as someone falls, I'm like, do a couple of charity laps. If they're not up, just come, sit down, have a rest. And just keep being up together and in the middle of the ocean, flying around. There's nothing that compares to that.
It all depends on your time frame. Like,
I don't have kids and I don't live in Sydney. So we don't have peak hour. We don't have all of this stuff. Like for us, it's a 15-minute drive, 30K run home. And that's kind of it. Whereas I know I talk to on the eastern beaches. So you guys are up north on the south of the Harbour Bridge and the eastern beaches, Jeremy, Josh Crew and Perth.
Yeah.
And I think Ben did a downwind run and they said the car shuttles for a 9 or 12K run took 4 hours.
That's why I am.
That to me just like went out the window. I was like,
not worth it.
The ratio for probably, I think Jeremy said it was almost 30 minutes on foil for 4 hours of car shuttles. I was that ratio is starting to lose out a bit.
And that's where my wife gets up. Like if I go with crew who are still learning, like if I do my own run, it's probably about an hour and a half door to door, like drive from my place to the start to the finish back home.
Yeah.
And like if she picks me up, we can literally on a 12 to 15K run, it can be an hour and a half or a 20, changes to 2 hours maybe door to door on a 20, 25K run. But when you go with someone and they're struggling to get up, they come down, that 2 hour window becomes 4 hours pretty quick. Basically.
Yeah.
So it's like, how many brownie points do you want to use today, James?
Exactly right.
So it's like, I could either do one run by myself or I could do the two runs by myself or one run with someone who's learning. And it's like, it's better be fun.
And that's what it is. You've got to find guys that you can do it with. Like I've been wanting to do longer and longer runs and it's sort of that, it is better to be with someone for safety reasons and it's just funner.
Yeah.
But also it's just you need someone who's as soon as you come down, I think the most energy you waste is paddling back up.
Yeah.
Once you're on foil, you're just you're not wasting a whole lot of energy. Like an hour downwind runs, you're ready to go again straight away. Whereas if you've got to paddle up five times because you kept hitting weed or something, you're pretty tired at the end.
Yeah.
And so that's where, if you've got to keep coming down, it sort of affects how far you can go. So finding partners for me has been the latest. And then, I don't live near too many other guys that are really into downwinding. So it just ends up being, I'll just do it by myself.
Yeah.
Most efficient way, really.
Uber downwind. Yeah.
Uber downwind. Yeah.
Seriously.
That's it.
I got to start wrapping it up. But I guess what else do we want to chat about? I guess anything else that you've, has been, big. Ooh. A big breakthrough for you. Like I'm pretty impressed with your prone. How's your sup downwind going since we spoke last?
My paddle up.
Yeah.
The paddle up's been the biggest learning curve. I've spent some, I think being the weight I'm at and having, I started with my own boards and I went pretty aggressive. I was like, just under 6 foot. I went 22 wide, which at the time everyone was like, what are you doing? Yeah. Like that's stupid. And I was like, no, like it's going to be better. And like, so I got on, and then because I'm light, but I'm big foil. So it wasn't it was quite an easy learning curve. So I actually wrote off a lot of the kind of learning to get up, perfecting my paddle up, really.
Yeah.
I got away with a lot of factors that were in my favor. And so now I've kind of gone back and went, all right, now I want to try to get up some smaller wings and actually try and progress.
That was going to be my next question. How small a foil have you paddled up now?
Ooh, Hood River. Me and Mateo did a run. We were doing a couple of laps at the hatchery and we decided, like, let's go really far up. And we got dropped way up and we had to be back at the event site for the event. And we got dropped up there and it was like ankle high little like slappers.
Yeah.
And I was on a 93 mast with a 925 and he was on the 93 mast with a 725. And I'm talking like the worst bay run conditions you could imagine. And so for me, that was a good practice and a good sort of, I got the 925 up, but it took 10 minutes to get it up. Same, he probably was another 5 minutes behind me on the 725, but
but that was pretty much like it's almost flat, bumps that you had to paddle over. It's like almost speed bump paddle up.
And so, watching Mateo paddle up, I learned so much about his technique. He's a such a weapon paddler.
I'm trying to get him on the podcast, but he's got school. Oh,
he barely goes to school, let's be honest. No, but sort of, and that was one thing that, you know, I think the Armstrong high aspects are like that. That high stall speed means you've got to get them going to get them up on foil. And your biggest thing is that getting the board speed up, because ultimately, you know, I sort of had learned initially on the axis because it's just, I could get them straight up. I didn't really have to do the whole pump paddle to work them up. I could almost just get enough of a push and bump, get up and just rely on my pump.
Mm.
And I think riding those high aspects and seeing, especially seeing him in Hood, the way he, you know, he starts with a bump and gets the push and then cuts so aggressively to the side to stay with bumps. He doesn't run into the one in front as he's working that speed up. And the last thing you'll do is he'll do a big hard paddle and jump behind the wave, and you'll then pump into the back of it and get that drive off the back of the wave and then sit in the one behind it. And that kind of drive, even on a tiny foil, just got him up on foil and he was right.
Yeah.
And I'd never, you know, seeing what we, you know, anytime I do, I was just paddle dead straight, work it up and keep going. But seeing how he just thought about, you know, just rips in behind and then got straightens up. And I was like,
yeah,
all of a sudden that really helped me with kind of the higher stall speed wings and paddling them up. So
for sure. And especially because those foils are going so fast, you have to paddle fast. So you're, sometimes you're paddling faster than the actual bumps.
Yeah.
And so, the smallest foil I've paddled up is the 725, and it's the closest I've been to paddling back in. I almost didn't get up. It was like 10 to 15. It was a good day, 10 to 15 knots south to southeast wind at home. And I had a mate buzzing around me on a e-foil, and I wanted to tell him to, you know, get lost. I'm in a not happy right now, you know, slap the paddle in the water sort of thing. And I finally got it up after probably a good 10 minutes.
Yeah.
But I think the biggest problem for me was coming from go foil and using axis stuff, the Armstrong 725, I couldn't get in my old board, I couldn't get far enough forward. So I was getting the speed, but every time I pumped, I stalled out because I was standing too far forward. So that was, and more excuses. God, I'm all full of excuses.
No, I 100% agree with that. And that's where, you know, Armstrong lift, they ride further forward in the boards. Boards never had long enough boxes for them.
Yeah.
It was, you know, you've got to stand where the board floats. You can't stand where you want to be on foil. Exactly. You got to paddle the thing. And you're paddling up. And it was the same when I learned on the Sonova. It was like, you start to get lift, but you realize you're just like, whoa, I got to get
paddle back. Stance here. Yeah. Foil stance here. Yeah. It's like you got to get so far. As I did a clinic today down here in Torquay, and a guy was using a Takuma board with a lift foil, and he was paddling a long way, you know, foil forward.
Yeah.
And his foil was as far forward as we could get it. And then when he got on the wave, he had to go like 1, 2, 3, 4. And then that was his stance. And it was like the whole session was like, we need to get you further back. He's like, I'm running out of board behind me. It's like, that's not the best match. But
I think as well, one thing that I learned was playing with the base plate shims actually, and how that affects paddling up. And I think it was something that I didn't think about. I talked to Simeon, who one of the Hawaiian Voyager guys, and he sort of explained it really well. And he said that, you know, essentially, you know, the angle of your board affects the angle of the foil.
Mm-hmm.
And I think for an Armstrong foil, so you're looking at, I guess, how you shim your mast will affect how you, the angle of attack of your foil.
Yeah.
So if your foil has a heap of angle of attack, or say the nose of the board when you're on foil is down, it'll come up quicker.
Yep.
But you need to find that right angle for the foil that you're on. So especially with the Armstrongs, if you've got too much angle of attack, you'll paddle it in and that angle of attack will start lifting the foil, but you're not going fast enough to engage the foil section and then keep going. So it'll stall. So you start flattening it out and you start getting more board speed going, then it starts lifting, but then you're as high enough speed to engage the foil section and then you're off and going.
Mm.
So that was one of the big things for me, dialing the mast angle in using base plate shims. And that really has made actually a lot of difference to my paddle up, which was something I didn't expect, just not something that I thought about. And similar to mast position, Simeon was explaining that he runs his mast a bit further back so he can get the board speed up.
Yep.
I think they're in pretty incredible conditions where they're trying to actually catch the waves and get up.
Yeah.
Whereas I'm still kind of working it up. So
Hawaii is a special, you know, Oahu's more real world than Maui, but it's a good real world. Yeah, it's a really good real world spot. Yeah. And they definitely, like you said, look behind. And I try to look like maybe 45 degrees to 90 degrees to my side. Like, because anything that's behind you, if I'm looking like this, the bump that's coming, that's standing up here, has disappeared by the time it gets to me. Generally, yeah. It's just a really good bump. And I'm not saying I never look behind me, but if I see a set coming, I'll then draw my attention to the nose of my board in front of me and look for that, you know, that little scoop. And that's telling me more than this behind me.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
No, I still 100%. Look behind me though, but every time I get up, it's like I'm looking in front.
Yeah. No, 100%. And there's so many of those little things that, yeah, I'm still learning. Every time I paddle out, I'm learning. I'm trying to now replicate what Mateo is doing. You know, I learned to do that in Hood, but now trying to do that in the ocean a little bit.
Yeah.
And try and get the side speed and pull off one and, you know.
In the ocean, I feel like it can be almost easier because in Hood, because it's so straight, you have to go boom, boom, boom.
Yeah.
Whereas in the ocean, because there's refraction and all sorts going everywhere, you can kind of get onto one. And then because there's a little bump running back this way, you can come back that way. And then you get another one this way. It's like, okay, that's my one I want. And you use the speed to sort of hop between them. But definitely, you can't paddle. You can only paddle straight in a perfect bump. But if you can learn to zigzag while using your speed, you can get up on the imperfect bump, I guess, or the worst bump.
So it's cool. I mean, that's where it's interesting where it foiled. And I think to anyone who's listening to this, who's new to downwinding, we're all talking about high aspects, fast wings, all that. Don't be scared to go to an old, slow, big foiler because it's, like we're saying, it's all about just getting up on foil. And if you spend your time trying to paddle up, you know, fast, high aspects, they are harder to paddle up.
Yeah. And that's the other thing I'll add to that is the big, slow foil that doesn't glide as well teaches you a skill that you'll need to know regardless of what foil you're using. I learned on the Maliko 180 and then the Maliko 200. Marcus Tardy learned on the Maliko 280 in Perth. Massive, and he's like he's lighter than you. He's like 65 kilos. He would have been lit. But what he learned really well was on one bump, peel off, get the bump behind catches him, peel off, catch him up behind, and that's what downwind foiling is. It's not. I'm not. You know, people say I caught one bump and I went all the way to the end of the run, 10 k's on one bump. Nah, no one's doing that ever. You might get a really good bump and you might maybe go a kilometer, maybe a little bit longer, and that's like. Even that's recycled, the bump's recycled a couple of times and you've had to turn and sort of link, but you're never on one bump for the entire run. And that as bad as slow foils are, a slow foil teaches you the necessary skills that you'll need even with a fast foil. On one bump, pull off. On the next bump, pull off. The slow foils in the ocean, you'll have to do that peel off more, but that's exactly what you need to be practicing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's hard. For sure. Like, it's hard to be on a foil that's too big for the conditions. And ideally, you're on a foil that's perfectly matched to the conditions. But there's nothing worse than being underfoiled, which means A, you're not getting up, or B, you get up and you have to pump the whole way down the run. And you learn nothing about downwind if your foil is going faster than the bumps.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's, sooner, like Hood River, I think, was an interesting one where I think the Armstrong high aspects probably aren't that suited to it because. You know, like you see in those clips, I was just going back and forth. And like, if I tried to just cruise and go straight, it worked actually when I was out. If you go east towards Rufus, totally different bumps, longer, straighter bumps. And I could, but close to the hatchery is just wedgy. And so I was moving the whole time to stay with the energy pocket. Because if I just tried to cruise, I'd just drop out.
Yeah, having to turn to create speed, like on the wave.
Exactly.
Whereas if you go straight, so you were slightly underfoiled, like your foil was going too fast for the bumps.
And so that's where, it's high aspects aren't always the answer. And I think we've all come to this. I think we're in a realm of a high aspects at the moment, and there's so many options for them out there at the moment. And I think, moving forward, I still have a surf orientation. I still want to ride waves. And, I've kind of forced myself now with high aspects to ride them in the waves, but I don't necessarily think they suit a wave. Like downwinding, they are the best. There is no, like, the efficiency, the glide, the speed.
Yeah, I was going to say, instead of going a smaller low aspect, just go a bigger high aspect, and that's going to match it better to go slower. But for surf, for turning, I agree. I think
there's a big gap there. And I think, Armstrong Lift are great examples. And like I said before, Axis, I think they did it well because they've got that range in between. But we need to perfect the surf wings.
I'm
selfish because that's what I want. I still ride the ARTs and the HAs in the surf, and
I think there's going to be a bit of a, you know, you've seen Unifor with Eric from the Progression Project developing that sort of, it's a high aspect wing, but it's a high aspect wing that surfs better. And it's this, it's a jack of all trades. I think there's going to be your downwind, like speed wings, your all rounders, and then your specific surf wings.
Yeah.
That's where I want it to go anyway. Like, I think you need your high aspect race, and it's going to be, they're going to be unturnable eventually because they'll be faster. Like, not unturnable, but relatively. And if your jack of all trades is going to be your most fun everyday wing, and then you're going to have your surf wing, which you're not necessarily, you're going to be compromising pump on the way back out, but it is going to, like, you'll be ripping on it.
So, no, there's any other foil brands out there, please? Keep developing. This is what we want.
Working, boys.
That's it.
And girls, oh, thanks so much, Oskar. It's been a blast chatting. It's always good. We lose track of time. I said to my wife, it'll be 45 minutes. We'll be done before nine. It's now almost nine.
Oh, we're nowhere near. No, it's all good. Oh, man, it's just good to chat about foils. My problem is I can, even after hanging out at Hood River and talking foils for 12 days straight, I was still leaving like, does anyone want to talk about foils?
Messaging people, how was the foils?
Yeah, that's it. What's this? What's that? We just froth it. And I think it's, an exciting sport to be a part of at the moment, and
absolutely
still growing. So
it's growing.
Keep pushing it, whether it's prone paddling, surf wings, whatever it is.
Jeremy Riggs, high kneel.
I saw that one. No paddle, just standing on it.
No paddle.
Yeah.
I want to see him do that downwind. And obviously, there's the same paddle as prone to sup. Sup, you can use a small board, small foil. Prone, you're probably going a little bit bigger board, maybe a little bit bigger foil. No paddles. No paddle, no hands. I think you're probably going to be using a bigger board and a bigger foil again. So there's, but they're all, it doesn't matter. As long as you're out there getting up and going and you're gliding the bumps, that is the main thing. So however you want to do it.
That's it. Let's get more people into it. So whichever way it is, let's just keep getting people out there.
Yeah. And I'm heading up your way in about a week. So hopefully get a little downwind run in and maybe have to do a little, I don't know, live Q&A sort of thing. Get a few crew from.
I like the sound of that.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Beauty. All right. Thanks so much, Oskar. And I'll be in touch. Thanks so much for coming on the show.
Yeah. Awesome. Thanks, guys.
And I forgot to mention, Oskar just came back from WA, but I'm trying to convince him to come over for November 10 to November 20. We're going to create like a little bit of a downwind month. And I know Zane's keen to come over and all that. There's heaps of downwind fall frothers over in Western Australia already. But November 12 or 13, I think, is the Mandurah Jewel. And it's like a pretty sweet section of coast for downwind foiling. It's about, I think it's only a 10 to 15K run. So it'd be a bit of a sprint on a foil, which would be fun. And then the following week, there's the West Coast Downwinder. And that's more like 25Ks, which I think is a really good distance for a downwind foil race. And that's up in Perth, North Frio to Sorrento. The organisers have said, yep, foilers, come on in. Let's go. So let's get behind it and support these races and get the foil froth really going. But yeah, Oskar, we try to get you there. But if you can't, all good.
I got to sample it last week. I got to sample Mandurah and run at Frio. And I can, the conditions they get are pretty unreal. So if you're thinking about getting over there, it's definitely worth the trip. It is next level, the foil, the downwind conditions over there.
There you go. Straight from the man himself. All right. Thanks, guys. We'll see you in WA.